the wine and the bread and the sons of the earth. How beautiful the feet that walked the long dusty roads and the hill to the cross. How
power. Welcome to Burnt Factory United Methodist Church. Grace and peace to you. I am Pastor Steve Malister, and we are so glad that you have chosen to join us for worship today through our live streaming service. It is our prayer and our hope today that you will experience the love of Jesus Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit, and the truth of the gospel message. Friends, no matter what is going on in your life today, no matter what challenges and struggles you may be facing, we want you to know that God loves you. And may God's peace be with you this day. No matter what you may be enduring, never forget that God loves you.
Should the shadows come? Oh, why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home when Jesus is my my constant friend is He. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches watches over me, over me.
Welcome you this morning to Burn Factory United Methodist Church, to our live streaming service. We are so glad that you are joining us this morning. This is the day that the Lord has made, and let us all rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord is our light and our salvation. Whom shall we fear? We are confident of this, friends, that we will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart. Wait for the Lord. I welcome you once again as we provide this live streaming service for you on this beautiful Sunday morning. And I, at this time, would like to invite our worship leader, Rob Moss, to come forward as he will share our call to worship and also our opening prayer.
Friends, as we gather, let us experience this holy time. Let us rest in the blessed assurance of God, and together proclaim our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We share in the Spirit of God, and in that spirit of community, let us go to our Lord in prayer. Will you pray with me as we seek his presence? God of compassion and forgiveness, make this time holy. We need you in this time of insecurity to impart your peace and patience. What is unknown is known to you, and it is in you we place our faith. Lord, touch each of us that we may rise to serve in your name. We are your people. You are our God. Bless each of us who worships you this day. It is in the name that is above all names, the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. You know, we still love our children, don't we? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Woo. You know what? Our children, we miss you. You know, you are life and energy to this place, our house of worship, God's house. And it's not the same since you're not here. But we're going to do the best you can, best we can, right? Come on in here. I want to show you something. Come on in. Oh, who could it be?
Since you're not physically here, this is the best that we can do. And those are some bright, shining faces. Every one of you is special. I almost forgot. I got somebody special here. Come on in. Well, who could it be? Hey, Miss Carrie, say hello.
Hi.
Hey. Do you miss the children?
I miss them so much. I miss all of you.
Oh. What, if they were here, what would we say to them? Maybe something like, let's make the best that we can. Let's do the best we can with what we got, which would be, hey, you can help out your mom and dad and your whole family. We're all in this together. So what you do can make everything better for everybody. What else do we think we should tell them?
I think we should tell them it's okay to go home and do your homework, do your schoolwork. We need to make sure we're honoring God by doing all of our work. I've also, you got your Bible packets. If you're in the kids' Bible club, you got to make sure you're doing your Bible packets, and we're going to earn double Bible bucks this time. And if you got a lovely package dropped off at your house, show me those. I want to see them. Tell your moms, put them on Facebook, because we want to pray for you, because we love you so much. We want you to have fun, even though we can't be together. Look at God in those packets.
Now remember, it was Miss Carrie that said about the school homework, okay? Just keep that in mind. Well, what else can we do? You know what? We always, not just kids, but everybody, is be kind to one another. As we said, this is us together. We're a community of faith, so be kind to one another. And what else? What else could we say?
We can trust and pray.
Amen. Trust and pray. We trust in who?
We trust in God.
Amen to that. You know, we do miss you. We miss you very much. You know what we can do, though? What we can do, we can pray for you because we love you. Let us go to our gracious Father, shall we? Let's go to him in prayer. Oh, Lord, we do thank you and we praise you that you are with each of us through all of this. But we know that you're with everyone that's watching us, that you're holding your children close. Lord, may they feel your presence and feel your peace and know that they are loved. We give this up to you, Lord. We give it up to the precious name of Jesus. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Mwah. You are special, and we love you very much. Be together soon.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need through.
Friends, in your homes, in your living rooms, in your dens, would you now bow your heads with me and let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God, we know that we can trust in you, and we know that you are with us. You will never leave us or forsake us. And as we worship together in the best ways that we can, we know that you are with us no matter where we are at. Continue to be with us, your children, your people. And let my words be your words this day. I offer them to your glory in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The scripture passage today that I'm preaching from is from Philippians, from the fourth chapter. I'll be sharing with you verses 4 through 13. Hear these wonderful words from the Apostle Paul, words of joy and of faith. Paul says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. So do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and by petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And finally, sisters and brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or have heard from me or seen in me, then put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you have had no opportunity to show it. So I am not saying this because I am in need. For I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. And I have learned the secret of being content in every and any situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through Him who gives me the strength." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Reverend Rexy Dunham shares a story about a good friend and a fellow pastor. His name was Doyle Masters. He was the pastor of St. Luke's Church in Memphis when he was stricken down with cancer. It was early in November of 1978 when the doctor informed him that he had an inoperable malignancy. Doyle wrote an open letter to his congregation. The letter sings with great confidence and joy in the sufficiency of Christ, despite his circumstances. I want to share just a part of that letter. He says this, "The options open to me medically are minimal, and at best, do not promise renewed energy or longevity. The other option is to turn this whole matter over to God and in faith pray for His healing and for His ultimate will." Doyle says that this is what I have been directed to do by God after much prayer and after spiritual surrender. What the future holds, we do not know, but we know that God holds it. And then he continues his letter. He says, "These past few days have rolled over us like an avalanche, leaving in their wake some central truths which make up my thanksgiving list. Out of the dark night," he says, "the dark night of the soul, has come the sunlight of God's love." And he says, "You know what? I'm thankful for God, who is real and who is personal,
for a Christ who is present in my heart and in my life and in power. And I'm thankful for the Holy Spirit that is by my side in every struggle. And my gratitude, he says, overflows for a faith that is unwavering in the face of seemingly insurmountable obstacles. And for the personal practice of prayer, I'm thankful that brings all God's promises to bear in any situation. And then Doyle concluded his letter. He said, my Thanksgiving list is made this year, not from what I have, but from whom has me. A God who is able to exceedingly and abundantly above everything, do everything that we ask or think. That's the God that we worship. Doyle knew the all-sufficient Christ. And he could affirm, as Paul did, especially if we read a little farther in Philippians in the text, if we go to the 19th verse, Doyle knows what Paul wants us to know, that my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and his glory by Christ Jesus. So once again, Paul shares with us today, rejoice in the Lord always, and let your gentleness be evident to all, because the Lord is near. So do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and by petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And then the peace of God, which transcends our understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus. Dunham goes on to say about his friend, he says, you know, my friend Doyle died at the all too early age of 48. And as I sat in his memorial service seeking comfort for my own grief, he says, I reflected upon my friend's life and about our relationship, and especially upon his last sermon. The theme of that last sermon was one day at a time. And he made these three points. The last sermon he gave on this old earth, he made these three points. And he said, point one was, today is all that we have. Today is all that we have. Point two was that today is all we really need. And point three was, today is really all we can handle. Talk about embracing the sufficiency of Christ. What a legacy to leave. We can live with greater intention and purpose and meaning if we keep in mind that this day is all we have. We can live for today and do the best we can for today. So we must make the most of every day, to be kind every day, to be compassionate every day, to choose to be a peacemaker every day, to choose grace every day. Next is to understand that today is the only day we need. There are things that we can do and need to do today for God's glory, for the building of the kingdom. There are some steps that we can take today, and those are the only steps we need to take. So perhaps today we need to forgive someone. Perhaps this day we need to go see someone and speak with someone that we love who means a lot to us and tell them how we feel about them. And maybe we need to, on this day, stop contributing to disunity. Perhaps we need to turn off social media, turn off the news, and to choose goodness this day, to choose serenity this day. We can accomplish much for God's kingdom in just one day. Make a difference today, because it is all we have, and it is because it is all we need. And third, today is all we can handle, but we can handle today. Freedom comes, friends, when we take our anxious eyes off the future, when we cease anticipating all the problems and difficulties of tomorrow and focus our energy on today, on the present. And yes, planning is important. Yes, due diligence is a good thing. But let's handle our stuff for today. And we handle it through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and by the power of the Holy Spirit. Pastor Doyle's life and faith and the last sermon he preached was a marvelous example of what Paul's trying to get us to understand, and that is that Christ lives. And because he lives, we live, and we have a choice. We have free will, and we can choose to live in worry, or we can choose to live in victory. We can choose to live as the lost, or we can choose to live as the saved. We can choose to live in confidence, or we can choose to live in doubt. One way or the other, Christ lives, and Christ still reigns. And because he reigns, we can be triumphant. Triumphant over life, triumphant in our death, and triumphant over these difficult days, and especially triumphant over the specter of COVID-19. Paul says, I've learned. Have we learned? I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I also know what it is to have plenty. But I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry. What is that secret that Paul's trying to get us to understand? The secret is simply putting our faith and trust in the supremacy of Jesus Christ. God's presence in our life and in our heart is what we need. Knowing that no matter what comes our way, we have a God who will see us through. We have a God to lean on and to cling to and to rely on and to trust. It is mysterious. It is unfathomable in many ways, but it is true nonetheless. God wants us to be at peace in all situations in our lives because he loves us. He cares for us when things get tough. God wants us to bring our cares, our burdens, our suffering to him. Verse 7 assures us, if we do that, then the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. For God will be there for us in all circumstances. And yes, we can rejoice because Jesus is supreme, and through the blood that he shed for you and me and for the entire world, he has established his supremacy. He established it through his obedience, and therefore we exalted him to the highest place where he has been given all authority and power and honor and glory. And because of his supremacy, we can be content whether well-fed or hungry, and whether living in plenty or in want, or whether we are living or dying. Verse 13 assures us that we can do everything, everything. Everything through him who gives us strength. The presence of Jesus Christ in our heart will transform us. It will heal us. It will strengthen and guide us. It will bring us courage and love and faith. The presence of Jesus in our heart will equip and empower us, will bring us truth, wisdom, and repentance. The presence of Jesus will lead us to do what we never thought we could do in a million years. We can, through the power of the Holy Spirit, with Jesus in our heart, reach out and love the unlovable, forgive the unforgivable. We can choose honor and nobility over deceit and envy. We can choose those things that are right before God over those things that the world would tell us is right. And yes, the presence of Jesus can bring us through the valley of the shadow of death. for we can walk with Jesus through life's most difficult transitions, and Jesus can lead us through those transitions, even from this world to the next. We can rejoice. That's the good news today, because through the supremacy of Christ in our lives, we know without a shadow of a doubt that heaven awaits for us, and that Jesus will not leave us alone, and that we can overcome and persevere, just as Paul tells to us, we can all stand firm in the supremacy of Christ Jesus, who will never leave or forsake. Savilla Martin, who had already wrote the wonderful hymn, God Will Take Care of You. She was traveling with her evangelist husband, Dr. Walter Martin, back in 1905 up in Elmira, New York, when they struck up a great friendship with a wonderful couple by the name of Doolittle. Now, Mrs. Doolittle had been bedridden for 20 years with bad health. Her husband was confined to a wheelchair, and despite their afflictions, they were the most joyous people they had ever met. They encouraged and uplifted everyone who came across their path. They chose, no matter what, joy. They chose to live one day at a time, because one day was all they had. That was their mantra. One day was all they would need, and one day was all they could handle. So one day, while visiting them, Dr. Martin commented on their zeal and their hopefulness, their faith, their love, and their joy, to which Mrs. Doolittle responded with references from Scripture, from several places in the Gospel of Matthew. And she said, you know what? His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Well, the beauty and the simplicity of Mrs. Doolittle's expression stirred the imagination and creativity of Savilla. And she wrote these wonderful lyrics. Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? And why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. So I tell you what, I'm going to sing because I'm happy. I'm going to sing because I'm free, for his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. The late and very great preacher, Peter Gomes, said, hope's greatest power is that it enables the present by embracing the future. Hope does not deny the circumstances of the present, and hope does not help us get out of our difficulties. Hope doesn't get us out. Hope gets us through. And friends, it will get us through the world we live in today. I am praying unceasingly, as I know you are, for the demise of this virus. And I pray that lives will be saved, that spirits be restored, that healings will take place. But most of all, I pray that through adversity, that true unity can once again be established. That through this pandemic, we can somehow, some way, put aside and actually put away forever our continued polarization and intolerance. This is a time to pull together, to rally behind the truth. What truth is that? That we not only need God front and center in our lives, but we also need one another. Perhaps God will take this opportunity to wake us all up wake us to the possibilities that exist when we stop yelling at each other long enough to actually listen to each other. Wake us up to the possibilities that exist when we choose to be civil and respectful of dialogue. Wake us up and see what happens when we stop trying to find someone to blame for everything. Perhaps in these trying times, God is asking us to think about those things in our lives that we take so for granted. Things like hugging one another. Things like the importance of touch to those that are ill. Things like the great custom of a handshake. Things like gathering in community to celebrate the events of our lives. Things like being free to travel. Things like having fully stocked shelves. Perhaps, God, we'll use this time to ask each of us to appreciate those in our community who serve, like teachers, and nurses, and doctors, and healthcare workers, and so many, 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 many more. Maybe God wants us to take this time to reflect upon and not take for granted the great freedom that we have to gather and to worship our God together. I miss each and every one of you, and I appreciate each and every one of you. The old saying is true. Sometimes we don't know how much we miss something or someone, how much we love something or someone, until it or they are gone from our lives. Friends, we will survive. We will endure. That is not only what Christians do, it is what Americans do too. God is alive, friends, and is in control. And let us take one day at a time, and let's live for that one day the very best we can. Today is all we have. Today is all we need. Today is all we can handle. Let us pray. May the Word of God speak to you this day. May you be renewed and refreshed in the gospel truth. May the good news strengthen your faith, confirm your hope, and bring you to the great and glorious joy of knowing that God loves you and that God is watching over you. Amen. As we close our streaming service this morning, I want to share with you a prayer as we begin with a passage from the prophet Isaiah. In your living rooms, in your dens, on your phones, however you're joining us today, would you take time, if you can, wherever you're at, to once again bow your heads and let us go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty and most merciful God, your prophet Isaiah says to us that when we pass through the waters, the Lord God will be with us. And when we pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over us. And that when we walk through the fire, we will not be burned, we will not be consumed, the flames will not set us ablaze. Thank you, Almighty God, that in the midst of this pandemic, we all at times must feel like we are living just below a dam that is holding back potentially devastating floodwaters. And at times we must believe that just outside our doors there's an all-consuming fire ready to engulf us. drowning and being burned are images that evoke great fear and trepidation. But the promises of God are sure, friends. God will walk with us, will swim with us. God will be our life vest in this great tide of struggle. And God will also be our firewall and our shield as the flames of fear try to ignite doubt. In these unprecedented days of uncertainty and apprehension, let us take comfort and peace in God's assurance. And let us stand strong in the faith and do our part in unity for the greater good. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, for great is your faithfulness, Almighty God. We pray today that God will wipe this virus off the face of the earth and that those who suffer from it will be healed. We pray for all everywhere who are tasked with being on the front lines of this fight. Keep them safe. We pray, Almighty God, that we will come together and put away our differences and come to know the great truth that has always been the fiber of our great country and our great church universal. That when we need to, when we have a common goal, when our backs are against the wall, when the floods are on the way, and when the fires are burning outside our doors, we will pull together. And in one united voice say, we shall not be defeated. With God's help, friends, we will pull together and we shall overcome. To the glory of God and to His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we shall not be moved. And this virus and all that has come with it will have no power over us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. And now, friends, may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, may that great shepherd now equip you for every good thing to do His will. And may He accomplish in us what is pleasing in His sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom all glory forever and ever. Amen and amen.
Should the shadows come? Oh, why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion,
watches over me.